Welcome to City and State TV. I'm Executive Editor Michael Johnson. When Governor Cuomo signed an executive order to create a special prosecutor in cases of civilian deaths at the hands of police, he did so at John Jay College. The Institute has become a leader in criminal justice reform efforts, and we're pleased to be joined by the president of the Institute, Jeremy Travis. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
We'll start with the special prosecutor. I want to talk to you about a lot of other things, but we'll start with the special prosecutor that was created by Governor Cuomo. Obviously, he wanted to get legislation to get this passed. He had to do it through an executive order. Do you think this is an effective step towards kind of handling the police versus community relations? Let's talk about that first, and then we'll talk about the larger concept of having a special prosecutor. But on the police-community relationship, is this a good first step to try to rebuild that divide that we've seen here, but also nationally a little bit?
Well, what we've seen nationally is that one of the flashpoint issues that comes up, unfortunately, from time to time, is the issue of individuals who die at the hands of the police. And those are always contentious, particularly when there's a racial element involved and the individual is an African American, and particularly when the person is not armed. So in our criminal justice system, the way that we address those questions of what happened and was the use of force justified is typically by invoking a grand jury power to do an investigation, and then the grand jury does what a grand jury does. And in New York, but also nationally, if you remember what happened in Ferguson, there's been a lot of controversy about the effectiveness of those investigations and the fairness and the openness and the, in essence, the legitimacy of the grand jury process. So the governor had introduced legislation, as you mentioned. That legislation did not succeed in the legislative process. He also made a commitment, principally to the families of a number of people who have lost loved ones to the hands of police. He made a commitment that he would do what he could do within his executive powers. Hence the executive order. We're honored that he chose John Jay as the place to have this historic signing of the executive order. And his commitment is to continue the legislative push. In my view, certainly it helps in his agenda to have an executive order in place designating the Attorney General, Mr. Schneiderman, to be the special prosecutor should the need arise, so that we get comfortable with this idea of there being a special proceeding, in essence, in these high-profile cases. So it's a big step forward. Governor gets credit for signing the executive order and for introducing the legislation. And Mr. Schneiderman had also proposed his designation. Yes. So they're working very closely together on this. And we have now a period of time where the legislative process will kick in again, and hopefully there'll be legislation passed next session.
How important is it to set up a process? Because, I mean, it's under my understanding that the governor could have appointed a special prosecutor on a specific case. He could have appointed a special prosecutor on the Eric Garner case when it happened. He had that power kind of all the time. This kind of seems like, though, like this is setting up a process so people know what the system is going forward. In your experience, how important is that? Because obviously criminal justice is both sides. You have the people in law enforcement who have to, uphold these laws, and you have the people who maybe feel like they're being slighted by the law that, are frustrated and looking for some kind of, clear guidance on what's going to happen going forward.
You're right. The governor historically has had that power to appoint a special prosecutor, and that's been used from time to time. We need only remember the Howard Beach incident where Joe Hines was appointed. So that power exists in statute. What Governor Cuomo has done and what Mr. Schneiderman called for, and we hope will be enacted by legislation, is to say that this will now be routine rather than on an exception basis. This will be the way that these cases are investigated. What that allows the system to do and what is now happening, the Attorney General has now reached out to all the district attorneys throughout the state to say that if there is a need, if there is such a death at the hands of police, here's how his office is going to proceed. Here's how he expects the DAs to work with his office. Here's how he expects to carry out investigations. So in essence, we're taking this time as a state, as a criminal justice system, to start to set the protocols in place should the need arise. We hope the need doesn't arise, but the life of our cities and the work of our law enforcement is that sometimes force must be used. And in those cases where it must be used, we have to decide as a community, as a state, whether that use of force was appropriate, justified under the law, or inappropriate that would require a criminal prosecution. So in essence, we're doing the test run. We're getting the procedures in place at this period of time under the executive order.
I want to step back for a second and talk about the national picture as well, because I know that John Jay College is part of the national initiative for building trust, something the Obama administration reached out to you guys to be a part of. Is your sense that this idea of a special prosecutor and some kind of check on the DA system on a national level a thing that is going to help the community police relations going forward? Is this something that you feel like has gained momentum and is something that's kind of not necessarily inevitable, but something that you feel has been a positive impact in helping repair what's been a rift that has existed in many places for a long period of time?
Well, certainly as we look nationally, this issue has come front and center. Ferguson, Staten Island, and other situations where the question on the part of the families and the communities and those who have demonstrated is whether there was a clear determination based on the facts, whether there had been a violation of law that could proceed to a criminal trial. And we have grand jury secrecy laws that are different state to state that tend to impede the public's knowledge of whether the grand jury decision was right or wrong. We had that in Staten Island. We don't know what happened in the grand jury. In Ferguson, by contrast, the DA there decided that he could, under that law, release the grand jury proceedings. So it's not only questions of conflict, which is sometimes how it's seen as the prosecutor is somehow in a conflict situation with the police. I don't view it that way. I think this is a matter of public trust. So the public has called for removing some of that doubt by having a special prosecutor named, and that's what the governor has done through his executive order. But I think you're right to place this in the larger context of police-community relations. So here we are at this just remarkable time in our nation's history where there's a lot of turmoil, a lot of concern about these issues. We have people marching in the street. We have the Black Lives Matter movement. We have individuals calling for special prosecutors. We have the president having appointed a task force on 21st century policing that made really remarkable recommendations, where the number one recommendation, the number one pillar in that task force report is to restore trust. Mm-hmm. It's not to cut crime, it's to restore trust. Trust is the essence of good policing. You have to have the trust of the community. They have to give you information. They have to share intelligence. We have to know who fired the shot. We have to know that from people who might be involved in those gang activities, for example. So trust is the coin of the realm. So we're very honored that the Obama administration, through the Justice Department, chose John Jay and our partners at Yale Law School and at UCLA and the Center on Policing Equity and the Urban Institute to launch a multi-site initiative called the National Initiative for Building Community Trust and Justice, to work with police departments and community groups in six cities around the country to work on issues of implicit bias and legitimacy and procedural justice and training and opening up channels of communication between young people and the police, opening up avenues for a discussion about reconciliation, just to recognize that our criminal justice system often has done harm. Mm-hmm. It's done a lot of good, but often does harm. So how do we have that conversation? So we're at a different point in the country.
You say it has done harm, and I think it's probably important to admit that. And how are you seeing that? How important is it to admit that to the communities to help rebuild that trust?
It is not just important, it's essential. Mm-hmm. And what we see, again, nationally, is that a number of law enforcement executives, I'll just point out Commissioner Bratton has been in the lead here, but Superintendent McCarthy in Chicago, others around the country, have acknowledged the obvious historical fact, which is that the police have historically been used on the wrong side of the pursuit of racial justice. Police have been involved in supporting the Fugitive Slave Act, even in our own city, going back to the 1840s and 1850s. Police have been involved in enforcing laws of of residential segregation. So the police have been on the wrong side. And more recently, the police have been involved in a lot of the incidents that have led to racial riots and disturbances in urban America. And this is an unfortunate history, but we have to talk about history. We have to acknowledge that history. And when we get into an understanding of the what we call the era of mass incarceration, where so many people are being incarcerated for such long sentences, the justice system with the police at the front door, basically, but it's our sentencing policies and our prosecution and our judges, have been part of what is, in my view, a great racial injustice. And we have to talk about that. And if we acknowledge that and talk about a new era, which is where we are nationally, the president spoke in Philadelphia at the NAACP conference about a new era of criminal justice. It starts with that acknowledgement. Once that acknowledgement is in place and that understanding is in place, then you can have a very different conversation with the community. My colleague David Kennedy has this wonderful phrase. He says, every time there's a police shooting, white Americans talk about the incident. What happened? Mm-hmm. Should the officer be indicted or not? African Americans talk about history. This is seen as part of history. So that history is highly relevant to getting beyond where we are now. And what's so really exhilarating, starting with our president, is we have this conversation underway in the country about the injustices of the justice system. That's necessary to get to a new level of community trust.
And I think that you struck on just how big this problem is. It's a holistic problem over a lot of sectors and also the historical length of this. I think a lot of people say, like, we need change and they assume it to happen quickly. But clearly, you know, if we spent so much time getting to this point, it's probably going to take some level of time to get, you know, back to a different, to a better spot. How do you I guess, approach that and approach those expectations? How do you view this larger problem and tackle it bit by bit and make sure you're making progress and not falling back?
Well, it will take a long time to get where we need to be and to get to a place that's actually within reach. So I'm not at all pessimistic about this, but I'm realistic. It'll take a long time. I was honored to be asked by the National Academy of Sciences to chair the National Academy's panel on high rates of incarceration, where we reviewed the history of how we got here. It took us 40 years, over which time we quadrupled the rate of incarceration in America. We stand outside every other Western country right now in our high rates of incarceration. So it may well take us 40 years to get back to a reasonable level of incarceration and use prison only for the purposes for which it was intended and not these excessively long sentences we have now. In terms of police-community relations, I think we're actually poised to make breakthroughs in the very near term. The law enforcement community is ready. The research is there on legitimacy and implicit bias. The administration has supported the work that we're doing and that other people are doing. And in the six cities around the country where John Jay is now working, we are finding a real strong appetite to get to work. So that's very encouraging. To reverse mass incarceration, we have to change our sentencing practices, we have to change our use of lifetime imprisonment, we have to change mandatory minimums, we have to have a different approach to drugs, we have to have a different approach to mental illness and the mentally ill in our jails and prisons. That will take time, but there's just this remarkable appetite to make those changes, but to have them actually have effect will take decades.
And I just wanted to finish talking about prison specifically. And you mentioned obviously it's going to take time to make those changes to mass incarceration. But right now we're seeing what's happening in Rikers Island. We're seeing a lot of high-profile cases about the abuse that's going on there. Is there a short-term solution to making things better there that, you know, maybe is not just put more money towards it? Because it seems to me that tends to be the idea is like, listen, like this is the reality that's on the ground unless there's more money to solve the problem. But then, you know, people come back and say the lawmakers come back and say there's probably not going to be money there for you. So how do you address that? And what would be, I guess, your advice to give a short-term solution to help, build back the trust in the prison system, especially at Rikers?
Well, Rikers is exhibit A right now of an institution that needs reform. The need has been documented by the Department of Justice under U.S. Attorney Pete Barrera. It's been documented by other litigation that's brought these issues to the forefront. I just want to commend Mayor de Blasio for really just saying, I own this, I'm going to do something about it under his watch. And he has invested money. He's brought in a reform-minded commissioner, Commissioner Pont, who has a reputation for changing jails around the country. He's already said, we will not have young people in solitary. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just a bracingly simple, straightforward assertion that it's just not appropriate to have a person who's in this state of adolescent development be in solitary confinement. Yeah. So we have to keep people out of detention. That means alternatives to incarceration, the work that is now underway on more supervised release programs. Again, thanks to the de Blasio administration, a good step in the right direction. We shouldn't forget Judge Lipman's proposal as the chief judge to eliminate money bail. Washington, D.C. did it years ago. So the poor people are just not held in pretrial detention, mm-hmm. period. They should just not be held in pretrial detention. If they're dangerous, we should have them in pretrial detention, give them an expedited trial. The idea that Khalif Browder was on Rikers Island for 3 years awaiting trial, many of those months in solitary. And then when he was released, even though he was a student at CUNY, doing well, I've read his essay on solitary confinement. It breaks your heart. And then he went and took his own life. That should never happen again. So we have to, mentally ill individuals, young people, people who are too poor to make bail and who don't pose a danger to the society should just not be in Rikers or in pretrial detention. Long-term view, I think Rikers should be eliminated. This was a view of Marty Horn, our colleague at John Jay. Go back in history, Herb Sturz, when he was Deputy Commissioner of Criminal Justice, Deputy Mayor of Criminal Justice, had a plan to eliminate Rikers. We need to put those plans back on the drawing boards. We need a long-term plan that will take people off of Rikers. It's you know, there's nobody in Alcatraz anymore. The idea that we put people on islands because they have committed a crime or are charged with a criminal offense, that's just an antiquated last century idea. We need to have community-based facilities with good mental health treatment, access to family, because everybody who we put in prison or in jail comes back to live in our communities. We need to have a very different long-term vision, but the short-term is within sight. Reduce the population, speedy trial, mental health, services, supervised release for people who can be out, and legislation that changes the whole presumption so that we keep people out rather than keeping them in.
We're running out of time, but before I let you go, when you talk about closing Rikers, obviously that I think the alternative or natural next step would be to open up smaller prisons in more locations. We see pushback in communities all the time when they are proposed. So how do you convince people in those communities maybe that it's a better for the whole city or for them if they're saying like, hey, we're going to build a small prison in your community?
It takes time. It takes a lot of discussion with those community groups. They have to understand that a jail is not a halfway house. Mm-hmm. Jails are places where people are held in secure confinement, and that's not in that sense a risk to the community, and that jails can be good neighbors. The proposals that have been developed in our city and elsewhere are multi-use facilities, so a jail can be a good neighbor. They can be small facilities, and I think we need, as New Yorkers, to look at our own history. Governor Cuomo and before him Governor Patterson and Mayor Bloomberg launched an initiative to close upstate juvenile prisons and to basically start with the proposition that no young person from a New York City neighborhood should be sent upstate because he violated the law. He should be kept close to home. It's called Close to Home. So that Close to Home initiative has been a great success, and all of those facilities are now in our neighborhoods. They blend in. And we have federal facilities that you wouldn't know they were prison, right? Mm-hmm. So it's an architectural problem, it's a design challenge, but it's, in the first instance, a communication challenge to talk to communities to say that here's what a jail is. It is not going to pose a risk to your the safety, and it can be a good neighbor. And that takes time, a long time, but we can do a lot to change what's happening at Rikers Island in the short term.
Okay. Jeremy Travis, President of John Jay College of Criminal Justice, thank you so much for joining us.
Delighted to be here. Thank you.